Good morning, everyone. Been having a good day so far? This is mine at 10:42, basically at 10:36. My laptop completely and totally pooed itself. Because, you know, somehow they know. They can tell. Obviously, I haven't been talking nicely enough to my laptop recently. So, and unfortunately, on my laptop are all the VMs that I kind of need. PowerShell is such a thrilling topic. I know that you're thinking, you know, who's going to do it without demoing anything, ever? It's like, yeah, not so much. But anyway, so slowly coming back. Just I have my laptop up and running. I'm waiting for the VMs to come up a bit, but I might go ahead and get started. But I warn you, there might be a bit of delay while my VMs seem to be taking their own sweet time on restarting. No, it's still there, so that's good. All right, well, while I wait for that, welcome to Tech Ed 2013. Welcome to this session on conquering your fear of PowerShell, 10 ways to conquer your fear of PowerShell. My name is James Finley. I am a senior systems trainer at Old House Computer Training. Maybe you've heard of us, maybe you haven't, I don't know. You have now. I've been working in IT for about 15 years plus or so, give or take a couple. More on the give a few more on top of that. I spend most of my time working with Exchange, SharePoint, Link, a bit of Windows, VMware, all this kind of fun stuff. And as a result of that, one of the things I learned fairly early on and is that PowerShell is my friend. And if you are a Link, Exchange, Windows, VMware, SQL, or basically anything administrator in the Windows ecosystem anymore, and PowerShell is not your friend, you should probably start playing nice with it and trying to make it your friend, if you haven't already. Didn't freak me out too much when I started with it, to be honest, mainly because I came from a bit of a VB scripting background, going back a little bit far enough to think in those terms. So the idea of scripting and automating things and basically doing a lot more command line administration, not that foreign to me. And I think that helps quite a little bit. Now, first and foremost, what this session is or is not, just so you know, set expectations here. If you fancy yourself a PowerShell guru, this may not be the session for you. Not trying to be mean, you know, I'm not going to sit there and name and shame you on your way out the door or anything along those lines. But this is meant to help some of those people. Obviously, we're all IT professionals in here, so I'm going to work under the assumption that for the most part, we can all find, you know, if there's some PowerShell command in a TechNet article or a support article or a blog or something, that we can copy and paste that, and it will probably be just fine that you can sit there and make the minor tweaks and adjustments that you need to do to make it work for you. And that's fine. That's a useful thing. But on terms of your day-to-day administration, there's more to it than that. I find I use it more and more. Who here is an Exchange administrator? Okay, so yeah, nearly half of you. Who here is running Exchange 2013? Okay, not quite so many. A few. Who here is thinking of moving to Exchange 2013? Yeah. All right, well, obviously, if you're dealing with Exchange 2013, one of the things that you obviously are probably already aware of is that they kind of got rid of one of the management tools. Well, they beefed up one. They beefed up the, it's no longer called the Exchange Control Panel. It's called the Exchange Administration Center. But effectively, they beefed up the Exchange Control Panel and they got rid of the main back-end management GUI. And one of the things that has happened is that more stuff, there is now more that you have to do in PowerShell. It's just, you know, they didn't take everything. And that's the thing that you have to watch out for there. Here's a SharePoint administrator. One, two, three. All right, woohoo! Well, welcome, SharePoint administrators. On this one, there we go. Sorry, I've got VMs at least asking me for a logon, so that's a good sign. You know, obviously more and more, especially if you're looking at doing it on a larger scale. Yes, you can do things in the GUI. That still has a very nice full GUI management tool, but we're doing more and more. Link server. Any Link installations in here? Okay, yep. VMware. Who here uses Power CLI? Yeah, like four or five of you. So there's all these things, especially, and VMware, I think, is an important one there. realistically, it's not just Microsoft ecosystem anymore that is now saying, hey, we're going to use this PowerShell as a management tool. There is a lot that you can do with the VMware PowerShell module. It's pretty much fully functional, and VMware are showing no signs of dropping that off anytime soon. So we have all these things happening here. And so that's why PowerShell, it needs to become your friend. Like I said, I'm not trying to turn you into an absolute guru in an hour. Can't happen. You need more time than that. Having said that, it's not as bad as you think. The reality is a good couple days worth of time. Obviously, most of us don't have, I'll just sit down for 2 days and do nothing but play with PowerShell until I get good at it. Be nice. Doesn't tend to happen that often. But there are things. Now, first things first, what are first of my 10 tips for this? One, PowerShell ISE is your friend. The PowerShell integrated scripting environment. And they've made changes. In the very first version of PowerShell, this was an extra feature. You had to go into the features for the through Server Manager, go and add this in if you wanted to use this. They realized that, this is actually really useful and we need to look at this. And so, obviously, as soon as I have a VM that will load, we'll have a look at some of the new features. I mean, people go, yeah, but it's a scripting environment. I can just type in PowerShell. Yes, you can. And if all you're doing is, hey, I'm going to paste this one line from a TechNet article, yeah, you know what, fire up your generic, boring blue PowerShell window, type in your command, press enter. Then when you get get the results, you can go from there. But until that happens, let's go here. That's all the fun stuff. Of course, since my machine. First now, because my machine, I just basically did a forced shutdown on everything. So, of course, now it's all my VMs are going, why did you shut me down? All right. There's something we can look at here. So that's good. See the second. All right, so what I have here, I've just got a real basic environment for us to have a look at today. What we have is I've got a domain controller up here, just a Windows Server 2012 R2 domain controller. Windows Server 2012, not an R2, my mistake. Windows Server 2012, I've got an Exchange server. That's all I have. I'm trying to keep this fairly simple, straightforward for us. And if worst comes to worst, as always, we do have our normal PowerShell window in here that is not too bad in that size screen, but I'm not going to worry about it too much. Because really what we want is our PowerShell ISE. Couple of things that are really, really useful in the Windows PowerShell ISE. Windows PowerShell. Like I said, of course it didn't pick that change. First things first, you almost always, if you're doing a lot of work with management, you are going to sit there and want to take this PowerShell ISE, at a bare minimum, pin it to your start bar. More likely, what I tend to do is I just tend to pin it in my desktop, pad that in there. Now, the things that are interesting in PowerShell ISE, one is the remote PowerShell tab. One of the things that PowerShell started off with is like it wasn't that great for doing remote management. They added to that, they've been using the WinRM service. They added that in PowerShell 2.0 to make that so you can do it now over HTTP calls, which is handy. There we go. And here's my Windows PowerShell ISE. And they've expanded that in 3 and even now 4, which is coming out. Yeah, no. Don't really need the Server Manager. All right, it'll come up here eventually. I'm guessing it's the Exchange server with 8 gig of RAM running in the background, making my poor little laptop go, no, stop it. So we come in here. Anyway, I'm going to see in here. A few things they've done in here. One of the nice things in here is that I can now enter remote sessions directly from the ISE. That was one of those biggest problems I said with the ISE itself, was that great for working on scripts and doing some things in there, basic work on that. But doing remotely, if I wasn't really good on how to enter PS sessions and do all those types of things, putting those things in there. Second thing I find, as I got more and more complex, even just things I was doing, working on a PowerShell interactively, I find it wasn't just I'm not just typing this one command. It's okay. I need to put a variable and put a few string a few things together and make that work. And invariably, because I have fat fingers, I'll make a typo somewhere in there. Now, how do you know if you've made a typo in a PowerShell command? Because the result you get is what? Red. Yeah. As I like to say, blood flows red on the PowerShell. PowerShell, yeah, one of those first things to remember about PowerShell, if you haven't already figured this out, is that it, by default, it takes a no news is good news approach to feedback, which is a bit off-putting. You've typed in, you know, 3, 4, 5 lines, and press enter. It goes away, nothing happens. And all of a sudden, after a little while, okay, prompt, I can start typing again. You're like, did that work? I don't know. So you have to remember PowerShell definitely takes that no news is good news approach to feedback. Every command has. All right. Cool. We'll give that, see how it's going. All right. So, now, and let me see. One of the nice things I do like about this is zoom in. There we go. Can you all read that reasonably okay? All right. So I hate using those magnifiers when I do things. You only see that much, and you can't move around too much. So if we can see that. Now, I've already done one here. I was going to show you here. But basically, I've got my PowerShell open, PowerShell 1. That's just my local machine. Well, I also have a connection to AKL-EX1, which may, depending on if it's running, may or may not be working just yet. But one of the things I have in here, just I can basically start PowerShell Dexy, that's fine. But there's this button here, New Remote PowerShell Tab. Now I'm going to try that one, see if I get a better... It will probably throw an error at me, since... But basically, it's hard for you to read, but I just need to type the known name, fully qualified domain name, or get away with IP address. Now, obviously, it will come in here. Okay, now obviously with the following message, okay, that's fine. Again, my other one's starting up in the background, it may not be up and running yet, my Exchange server, so I will check that a little bit later if I need to. But it's really that simple. Now, obviously, this does not get around, obviously the machine's not running. Now, one of the nice things in Windows Server 2012 and with PowerShell 3.0 is that it used to be the Windows, the remote access in Windows 2008, and this is still an issue in 2008. By default, the basically the PowerShell remoting, what's the default for that in Windows 2008? Turned on or turned off? Off, yeah. So again, you can change it, and it's well documented. Go on, you know, you can find that it's just a simple, fairly simple command. You need to change that and put that in. So I can check that a little bit later if I need to. But from this, it's really that simple. Now, one of the nice things about this in the PowerShell ISE is, you know, by default, when I made this new connection, despite the fact that blood is flowing red on my PowerShell, is that there's no scripts, just have full screen. So actually, I do this pretty much almost all the time, even if it's local. I don't actually use the built-in PowerShell window anymore. I'm almost always using the ISE, because you know what? I can see all this stuff. It gives me access to other things. It makes it easy for me to do and shop and change, not have to sit there and try to move in and out of sessions within a window. I can just create these sessions and keep them as, and I can tab between them. Because here's my, you know, here's a remote session to AKL-EX1, which is not quite working. But here I am in PowerShell 1. There's a script I have. If I am going to be doing some scripting, the ISE will pay attention. So if I'm in that PowerShell window, I'm in that session, and I say new, click on the new button or go to the file menu and choose new, it will bring up a new script and it will assume it is going to be running against the computer that I'm in. If I switch to my other remote machine here, which is EX1, note that script is not there. That empty page is not there. And if I want to create one, that's fine. Now, I should note, all these scripts will save to your local machines, but they are ones that you can run from there. Now, the other thing I will add in here is that they have also added some basic debugging tools to the ISE. So again, when you're writing those longer, now I'm not talking hundreds of lines long, but even I've done some things, 10, 20 lines, okay, I'm trying to go pull a variable, go hook up to something, and press enter, and I do get blood flowing in the PowerShell, it's all over it, and I'm trying to dig through what it is. Sometimes the easiest thing is I just want to work through it one line at a time and see where it breaks. Now, obviously, in the past, and with older versions of the ISE, you can just go through, one of the options you do have for basic debugging is choose a line, click on the green arrow, it says run that selection. Run script, or the one next to it, run selection, F8. F8 or F9. Sorry, wrong one. The big arrow runs the entire script. So then I say I can go, double check, it color codes everything, makes it easy for me to see if I've done something stupid before I press enter. But I can also run a selection. I mean, I can do that one at a time. If you're dealing with more complex ones, I can use those debugging tools. So if you have some experience using debugging tools, you can set what they call breakpoints. And then basically use, there's a debugging window, debug tool, say, you know, run to the next breakpoint. So, oh, I know this chunk of code is good, so I don't need to go through that line by line and work through and get those stopping points, and you can work your way, see where the errors are coming from. As you get more complex, that's a handy little tool. But even to me, I'd say start with this one. You know, select the line, run it, and not have to retype them. Find where my typos are. I know this is not, you know, earth-shattering stuff, but if you're not familiar with this. Now, the other thing I like about this, obviously, is obviously you can see in this one I've set it up a little differently. I have a script window. I have my underlying live window. Very handy. Well, I just need to see what the syntax, or I want to test it before I put in the script. You know, great. It's completely interactive. Get service. So show me all the services that are running here. Great. I can put those in there. And we also have this pane over here on the right that is basically some basic help. Anyone seen this? Seen the commands pane? Anyone seen it? Really handy. If I pick one of these off, let's see. I can even filter name, get, dash. Let's do service again. If I click on it, gives me a nice little, I know it's a little bit hard to read, but what you can hopefully get from this is you can see that, hey, I can put in, here are the switches, here are the options I have on here. So by computer name, dependent services, include, exclude. And if I can type in the stuff, so I don't have to know the syntax. I just kind of need to know what I'm pointing at or what the options are. I don't have to know the switches. I mean, Alt-Tab is great, but sometimes if it's really complicated, something you don't use often, fill this in and choose either run, copy, so it'll build the PowerShell script, copy it, paste it into your script, or say insert into my screen. So that's actually just a really handy tool. Now, if you think, but that's not showing up, fine, I can close that. What that is, again, in my ISC over here, there is the show the command add-on. So I can turn that on, turn that off as needed. I can also make it a floating window if I need to. All right, so those are things. Now, I'm just going to do one more quick check. See if I can see if my Exchange server is hopefully up and running a little bit more. Nope, not yet. No, you're right. I've got a typo in there. That probably would help too. Thank you. Well spotted. I did mention I have fat fingers. All right. All right, that's okay, sweet. Now I'm just going to do a quick check here on this one. Make sure the connection's all right. I'm just trying to make sure that it is in the right session. No, it's not. Well, worst comes to worst. There we go, that's happy. So assuming I get the name right, I can tap that in. New PowerShell session, I'm in my session. I can now see my services. This is my Exchange server. So I can check that, get service, msexch star. It's always my, yep, there's all my Exchange services, nice and running. So I can see that. I can work, like I said, even if I'm not scripting, I can work in this live, so I can do these things. Now, there is a little bit of a gotcha to that, but we'll talk about that in just a little bit. So that's first thing. PowerShell ISE is your friend. Like I said, I find more and more I just work in that all the time rather than the default PowerShell windows. Despite the fact, even with that command window that shows up in there, one of the things I also find is that get help is my favorite commandlet. It remains my favorite commandlet. It is my friend. A couple things on here. Get help. If you've recognized the get help pipeline clip, what does that do? Yeah, basically puts it straight to the clipboard. Very handy, because sometimes it's just too much, you know, too much, can't read it all, dump it out to a text file, put it to the clipboard. More and more of the PowerShell help, especially when it is Server 2012, it's all online help. And so that's one of those guys you have to watch out for. So assuming you have an internet connection, you can say get help, whatever the commandlet you want, get help, space, the name of the commandlet you're trying to get help for, dash online, it will automatically take you out to the TechNet website and get the online help. You know, it's fairly straightforward. Get help, show window, if you'd rather have it show up in a window there. And the detailed switch gives you examples. And I can also get help about comparison operators. The nice thing about the show window is it shows in a separate window, so it doesn't fill up your PowerShell screen. So if you're working actively. But yeah, get help is my favorite commandlet. It's one of the things I get when people say, James, how do you know, what do you do and how do you know what all the commands are? I don't know all the commands. Never have known all the commands. I know how to drive it. I know the stuff I use regularly. Everything else I use get help for. You know, so that is one of my favorite tools. Followed very closely by get command. Get help is great if you know the command you want help for. Well, how do you figure out what the command is in the first place? Get command. The nice thing about get command, obviously, is you need to know roughly the name. Not absolutely, but a ballpark figure usually. The more you know, the happier you usually are on that. So, the more I know, get command. And if you're not really sure, there's a noun switch. So if I know the name, PowerShell is verb-noun, right? So if I know the noun, that's great. But even if I don't know it exactly, noun, S-E-R-V star. So it retrieves all the ones. Obviously, the more you know, the smaller that result set's going to be. But it gives me an idea. Because a lot of times, it really depends on context. Now, if I'm working in Exchange, I know, doing a search for something, if I'm trying to do mailbox management or database management or something, you have probably a rough idea what those terms are going to be, aren't you? Context is everything. So pay attention to that, and you'll know that, and you can pick this stuff up fairly quickly. So the more I know. The other thing I can then, if I'm not certain, what I also have, especially when you start dealing with all these other things, the way that PowerShell introduces or gives you commands are based on modules. A module is a set of commands for a given product of something. DNS server, DHCP server, obviously seeing more and more of this stuff. How do I know what commands I have available to me? Well, get command dash module, then the name of the module, that'll tell you. So if I switch back to my DHCP, I'll start to my Exchange server here, and let's make it a little bit easier to see. Get command module DNS server, I think that's the module name. Touch whip, there we go. It's a little bit hard to see. Let me pull that up a bit. So those are all the commands that have to do with server management. So you don't know that much. That's why the first thing I put on my slide deck, it says get module. So I'm not sure what modules are there. That's a useful one. Now the other thing I should note, with that on the get module command, get module by itself only loads those that are loaded. It's, oh great, DNS server. I'll be honest, this machine is an Active Directory server. It's a domain controller. So what module would you expect to see there? The Active Directory module. That's the thing, 2008 R2, 2012, all this stuff. Starting in 2008 R2, starting with PowerShell 3.0, modules now dynamically load. Older than that, so if you're still working with pure 2008 or even if you added PowerShell to your 2003 environments, module not loaded, you can't access the commands. Starting with 2008 R2 on up, if the module's on the machine and it's installed in the right spot, it doesn't necessarily load when I load up a PowerShell window unless I specifically go and say, open up an AD PowerShell module. Some of those tools have that kind of option. But so if you're not really sure, get module, list available. Okay, so on this domain controller, based on whether it's a DHCP server, a DNS server, AD, whatever, it will show you all the modules. Now, one of the frustrating things I will warn you about this, when you look at other products, Exchange, Link, SharePoint, SQL, all that kind of stuff, one of the things that we sometimes get is that not all of them use this module infrastructure. Most of them do, but not all of them. Exchange is one that basically it got in first. The Exchange family got in first about how they wanted to provide their commandlets to PowerShell, and they didn't use the module structure, and they still continue not to. So we've got something on that a little bit. But note, here's a list of all the modules that at least on this machine I theoretically could load. Now again, the minute I try to do something, new AD user, for example, to create a new one. Note, I don't know if you're paying attention, new AD, even though that module was not fully loaded, I have access to the commands anyway. And if I just do that, a new AD user, that's going to, again, it's not going to do anything. One of the things you'll note in here, supply, test, that's fine. Hang on there. If it has not loaded, and depending on how long it takes, what you might see is you'll see a pop-up window going, oh, loading module. It loads these things dynamically. This is very handy in scripting environments. If you are writing something you want to run later and automate, but I always say you still have the means to do that. I'm not going to look at all the ins and outs of importing module in here. It's easily enough found. But I would say you watch out for that. If you're writing a script, be wary that there is that difference between Windows 2008 and earlier and 2008 R2. So if you're not sure where your script is going to run, put in hard code the command in there to load a module. It's going to be your friend. It's one line, import module, the name of the module. If you want to get really fancy, you start putting in checks and things to make sure the modules are there and all that kind of stuff. But again, anyway, so that's it. Get module. So once you know the module you want, get command for that module. Here's all the commands that are at my disposal for that. Another one, get command parameter name. Very handy one. I won't demo that one for you. But basically, because I don't know if you've noticed, some not all commands have the same set of switches. The two that I like to use most frequently are dash filter and dash server. Anyone use those? Seen of those? And it drives me up a freaking wall that they are not consistent with which commands have a filter switch and a server switch and which ones don't. They're not consistent. Drives me nuts. Get command parameter name. So get command parameter name filter will give me a list of all the commands that actually have a switch that have built-in filtering, or the ones that have a server option to say, show me which ones that can actually work against other servers that are built into the commandlet itself. Very handy tool to have. So I know what it is. I have a rough idea. All right, so that's what I'm looking for. So those are useful things. Import CSV and for each. Those are definitely your friend. You definitely want to, especially if you're doing AD or exchange management. Or to be fair, any time realistically that you want to do, where did I just put that? There it is. Oops. Any time that you want to do bulk management of something, bulk creation, again, may not be even, but like I said, I use it a lot in AD and exchange management, where I'm managing multiple mailboxes, multiple users, this kind of stuff. Okay, and being able to look at this and use this. So the benefit here is of using import CSV is that I don't necessarily need to know. Now, I'm going to talk in the context of AD and exchange, which hopefully most of you are reasonably familiar. Anyone here ever used the older commands for doing importing stuff, LDFDE or CSVDE for doing bulk Active Directory management? Anyone ever done that? Gotta do that yet? Fun, isn't it? To be honest, I'll be honest, the biggest, especially with the CSV, I like CSV, great, easy to put those things in there. The thing that is makes it more complex is I have to know all the stupid property names as they're referenced in AD. If I don't get those right in my column, in my header row, then I think I'm trying to try, okay, what typo, all that kind of stuff. One of the biggest benefits here, now I just need to know PowerShell, because I can build a CSV file, I can make those column heads whatever I want, as long as I know what I called them. So I don't have to worry about what it was called in AD. I just need to know what I called it in my CSV file. Because what you'll end up looking like using these things is something along these lines. So the basic use of this syntax of using this import CSV, so I've got a couple there, one for mailboxes from an exchange environment on the bottom and one for user manager up top. $users, that's just a variable. So we're going to import it, store it somewhere. Think of it as a table. It's going to take that table out of a text file and throw it into memory for a little while. And just say, $users table is import CSV, give me where the CSV file is. Doesn't even have to have a CSV extension, text file's fine. Now the text file itself does need to have a header row across the top. That's the best way to do it. And then basically once I've done that, then you use this idea of for each. Now the key things you want to know about a for each command, for each, $user in $users. I could have called, now the $users, that references the line above it. It's pretty straightforward. The $user, I could have called that $Bob. Sometimes you'll see, like in programming things, I'll call it $item. Fine, whatever. Call it whatever you want to, make sure you haven't reused it, but I kind of try to make them make sense. So every $user in that set. So in other words, for each item in that set that I just imported, I want you to do something. In PowerShell, basic scripting, have to open up my brackets here, or my braces, sorry, they're not brackets. So here's the new AD user command, here's the name. $user.name, given name, user.firstname. Given name, user first name, account password, something we'll talk about here in just a moment. Look at this. Now, the big thing there is all I really need to know, I need to know what that user list looks like. So what this would look like in a more practical approach. Okay, so here I have my domain controller. Hold on, let me see. Make sure you can actually read that. There we go. So again, I have not used the active, I mean, I may have on accident, wasn't my point. I just put common language names in here, right? First name, last name, department, even put the passwords in there. It's like, okay, great. So as long as I've got that, I save that, and I've got that somewhere. To use that, all I really need is a script that looks like this. It's actually fairly straightforward. Now, unfortunately, I don't have WordWrap on, so here's that first thing I did. $users, import CSV. Let me clear my screen here a little bit. Import CSV users.txt for each $user in $users. All right, for each item in that set. Now, I've done, username equals. I've done one other thing. I'm creating a variable inside this list. I'm going to build a logon name, first name underscore last name. So I don't even have to put that in the CSV file as long as the building blocks are in there. Now the thing is, all I needed to know, I just need to know what those column headings were. First name, last name, you know, that's what it matches here. Not the AD names, what did I call it in the CSV? So what I'm doing here, for every item, go look up the first name column. So we're going to build a nice little text string here. First name column, an underscore, then the last name column. Once I've built that, new AD user. Here, let me get rid of this so I have a little more screen space. So for the SAM account name, again, how do I know those? Tab complete. Yeah. Again, at some point in time, yeah, you do have to figure out what the switches are for a command. I mean, there's no secret to that. Got to do your homework. It takes a little bit of trial and error. Not a big deal. The tab complete thing is your friend. So here's the SAM account name. $username, that variable, that string I just built the line before. Given name, $user.firstname, surname, user.lastname. So again, all I really need to do is figure out the switches. I can tab through those. That's what it helps for. I'm using that department. And then I've done something here, a little bit, convert to secure string, taking that password field, and let's pull that in there. So the reality is, I could have 500 users in a CSV file. And if I have more attributes, fine, put more switches on the new AD user command. But basically, three lines. If I want to modify users, same thing. Instead of new AD user, it would be set AD user. Have the right details in the CSV. Literally, put all the work in the CSV, a little bit in here, three lines. You know, and I can do this. Now, to be fair, I have not tested this script, so I fully expect if I tried, I've probably made a typo somewhere. But it looks okay, but I like to live on the edge. There's a good chance I'm going to get blood flowing red. Yeah, okay. Oh, I installed it. Hadn't tested. Turned off scripts. General warning. I said, hey, run any script. I don't care. Not normally a good thing to do in a production environment, but hey. Oh, yep, missed something in there. I think I know what I missed in there as well. I'm going to can out of that. I left it, like I said, the big thing, that part's simple. You need to still make sure you get your syntax right. I know my new AD user, I was just trying to basically get those points in there about how to pull the data out of there. I thought, I'm pretty sure I know what I left off. At the end of the day, that's why I also do scripting. You can test it, fine. The fact that it asked me for anything tells me I screwed something up. You know, if I'm trying to get this, that's why I run these things. That's why I also created a script that only had two entries. In there. So, but that's what you want to look at. So import CSV, learn how to use that, get comfortable with that. That becomes your friend. So again, that's what we've got running in there. So simple one. Now, if I put another one on here for my mailboxes, similar idea. For every mailbox in that set, do something, enable it. So if I already have users and I need to go do bulk management on my mailboxes. Now, related to that is using credentials and passwords. A lot of PowerShell commands, depending on what they're doing, especially if you're hooking up remotely to something, may ask you for credentials. So, okay, I need a user string, I need to do something. So before I can do this, then that's what I need to do, so I need to get a credential in there. So a couple things in here. Get credential will prompt you. give you a pop-up. So great for interactive, or if you don't mind a small amount of interactivity, if it's not a script that's going to be running and scheduled to run at 2 in the morning, something, hey, I'm going to import, I don't mind. So great, it's going to prompt me for credentials. I can also, the convert to secure string, that's another one that I can also use for that. That's a very handy way. So like on the import CSV, there was that command in there. Put that stuff in there. There's also get host as secure string. Basically, I can gather any information. So I can basically have a nice little pop-up box that said, what is the password you would like to use? Take whatever they type in, they press enter, it's going to store that as a secure string. And because I put the as secure string on that, when they type it in, they're just going to see dots. So those are all interactive ways. The convert to is great for if I'm, again, using import. If I really want somewhere in the middle, you can always, if you want to go a little more advanced, you can create a little function that you call in your script that will basically take a string and convert it for you or prompt you once for it, those types of things. So the types of commands, you know, here's the little snippets that, you know, I said, and I'd give you some code snippets, here they are. You know, here's a $cred, get credentials. That's how you capture the credentials. It's going to prompt, give me a username and password, and I press, type it in, press enter. So then if I have a command line that says needs, that has a credentials switch, and many of them do, if I'm going to do that one, then I'll put that in there. So that's one use. Here is the one I was as secure string, new AD user. So here's another one's password using the get host command. So great. It's going to bring a pop-up. It says enter password, store it as a secure string. Then again, in my new AD user command and that account password switch, feed it that variable. Very handy in an import CSV or like that kind of thing. Or here's the third one. This is what I was doing before. On the fly. Great for the import CSV. Sorry about that. Convert to secure string as plain text. So a couple gotchas on this one. If you want to use it, convert to secure string, store it as plain text for these PowerShell commands, and then there's the password, use a force switch on there, and then the rest of your options in that command. So again, they're not terribly hard to do once you know what the syntax is, but again, finding this stuff, it's one of the things that takes a little bit of time. You know, practical use of the credential one I have found. Where'd that go? I get it in here. Now, I need to open some scripts. There's a turkey I prepared earlier. Here's a script that I wrote. Now, one of the things we talked about modules. Remember how I said Exchange doesn't load modules particularly well? So one of the things we've done, I'll run this later. But the syntax for getting those things in here, there's a particular command that I needed to use that has this switch over here on the end, this one here. That's the part of, okay, it is one of those days. At the very end, it has that credential switch. That's the one we're talking about. So again, what I did, the very first line just said, hey, prompt me for a credential, type that in. So this kind of nature of this. We'll look at this a little bit later. But that's necessary for this new PowerShell session command to hook up to my Exchange server. That's a requirement for that particular one. I know it because that's how the way Exchange works, and I need to put that in there. So again, then we can look at some of these things in here. So that's a practical use of that. Tip number six. Step number six. PowerShell minute. Filtering is your friend. Now, a couple things on filtering. One, filtering made easy. A lot of commands, a lot of the get commands. Remember PowerShell, noun dash verb? Get something, get user, get service, get process, get whatever. You know, get DNS server zone. Or get DNS server forward lookup zone, I think is what it is. You know, whatever it is. Have one there. A lot of them, but not all. That's the thing I was saying. That's where that parameter name switch for the get command is useful. Have a built-in filter switch. Microsoft's recommendation for the filter switch is use it. If a command has it, use it. It's a more efficient means of doing it because they built the filtering into the PowerShell commandlet itself. The basic syntax of doing a filter will work either way, so that's okay. If, however, a commandlet, or one of those get commands does not have a filter switch, we can use that second construct that we have on there, the where object command. Anyone, you might see that as just where, same thing. Where object or where, it's the exact same commandlet. Now, I've got two lines up there. Where object, open braces, $_ name equals Bob or just name equals Bob. The top one with the braces will work on any PowerShell session regardless of what version of PowerShell. The one without the braces will only work on PowerShell 3.0 or newer. So they've tried to simplify the syntax and kind of get rid of some of all the funky stuff. If you're, again, if you're writing a script and you're not certain who the audience is going to be for that PowerShell script or what machine it's going to be running on, you're left with two options. One, you can write some code, some lines of the code at the top of a script to check which version of PowerShell, and if it's not one that you like, say, hey, you can't run this script. Or option two, take the time to write the code in a way that can run across multiple versions unless there's a really strong reason that it has to be version specific. Okay, so I find even though I don't have to, I still use that top one. Now, a brief explanation, just if you don't know, the dollar sign underscore, that represents every object in a set, because usually this comes after a get something, a pipeline in PowerShell, get something, get service, pipeline, where, name equals, status equals, whatever. So it looks at that result set, looks through it one at a time, and that's what that dollar sign underscore represents, that set in memory, and then find the property. Usually the biggest challenge with the where object is figuring out the property. There's no, how do you know what the property names are? There's no super secret way. My approach is I usually do a get service or get whatever of, that'll return one instance and see what all the properties it returned are. Now I know the property names. Now I know what I'm looking for. You know, there's lots of ways to do it. I just tend to go with the simplest way possible for me. And that's usually if I can get something, pull one, once I know the names. Where object is useful, just reduces my result set. Again, if you want to go advanced things, you can do quite a few more. You can do a lot with that too. Where's my other script here? It's probably everything crashed on me. There we go. Yeah, let me switch over to a script. You can also do more complex ones if you need to. So here is a script that I use in my training environments because I find when I'm running, you know, 5 and 6 Exchange servers on a single 32 gig or 16 gig host, it struggles. And if I try to fire them all up at the same time, I get cases where servers don't run. So what I tend to do is put this little script in here, two lines. Have a variable, a get command that's going to return all my services. But there's a where command, so show me all the ones that start with like Exchange. The other thing about the where object, obviously there's equals, not equals. There's a few things in there. So obviously one of the things is they're called comparison operators. Equals, not equals, like, case sensitive like, all that kind of stuff. But I can also get some fairly complex things. So I wanted one here that was all Exchange servers, that start mode was automatic but didn't actually start. So I take that entire set, and the second line of my little script here. For each item in that set, go through and try and start the services. In my training environments, that's kind of handy because I know that when I sit there and try to fire them all up simultaneously, it tends to overload the hosts that aren't designed to do that kind of workload, but yet not designed to run 5 Exchange servers simultaneously and they all start up at the same time. We start getting disk and CPU contention. It's not happy. But this fixes that. So great, everyone starts up, go run that, fixes everything one at a time. So again, that's just a simple use of that. Now, I would say on those filter, those ones that have a filter switch as opposed to having to use where object, this syntax here, you don't need the dollar sign underscore, but this stuff stays the same. So within that be filter, name, in usually in parentheses, name, like, msexch, or whatever it is you're filtering on. So we've got those things coming up in there. Now, like I said, if you want to the comparison operators, equals, what are they? And that's the one thing that a lot of times gets people who are new to PowerShell. They're just using an equal sign or not equals. They know the characters, like if you've done Excel or that kind of stuff. You just have to learn it's dash EQ or dash NE for not equals, you know, or dash like or dash match or like I said, there's regular expressions. If you want to know about all the comparison operators, what your options are, how to use them, the get help command at the bottom there is going to help with that. Active Directory bulk management. This is another one, PowerShell 3.0, when they started actually a proper Active Directory PowerShell module. So be careful if you're reading documentation. If you're using at least Windows 2008 R2 or newer, you can basically take advantage of the Active Directory module for PowerShell. I would recommend that. Yes, you can manage it using other means, basically going through what I like kind of like to call the .NET object backdoors. You can get to anything that it's useful, but now you're using generic stuff. It's not designed to help you with Active Directory management. These ones are. There's a very good article. There's a TechNet blog. Someone asked a question. Someone responded. How should I get at my Active Directory modules? And there's a very good article on that. Again, I would definitely look at all of these, and the recommendation was use these if at all possible, unless there's something that you need to do that they haven't built into the commandlets. That's their general thing there. So I'm not going to go through at this point in time and go through all each one of those, but I would definitely recommend those. They're fairly straightforward. So again, I put star AD user. There's get AD user, set AD user, new AD user. Feed those in. Look at those. And once you get that the basic syntax of those, you're going to be fine. But have a look at those. Combine that with the import CSV and the for each. Again, so we're trying to see where these things are tying together for you. Exchange mailbox management. This is a fun one. And like I said, a fair mark of you said you're Exchange managers or Exchange administrators. This is probably one of those getches. On Exchange, they have a command called get user. Now, if your Exchange server also happens to be, or you've got the AD module loaded and the Exchange one, get AD user versus get user, which one should you use? One of them, definitely. In this case, it depends on your point. If you're going to be doing Exchange management, use the get user command. That is an Exchange command that will retrieve basically user accounts that either are or are not mailbox enabled. It will pull the same things, but it retrieves them in a way that other Exchange commands will happily accept them. The built-in AD commands don't necessarily pass the objects in the same way, so I find I get kind of iffy. Depending on what I'm doing, it may or may not work. Okay. The other question we have here is the get user versus get mailbox. Those are both Exchange commands. What's the difference? Get user will return every user in AD, or whatever filters I put on it. And it will return all of just general AD properties. Get mailbox only retrieves mailbox enabled users. And it also only retrieves Exchange related properties. The two, however, are somewhat interchangeable if I'm needing to make changes. I can take a get user command, filter it out to look for, I'm looking for all the people who are in this department or this city or this whatever, and then pipeline that into a set mailbox command to modify the mailboxes. By the same token, I can say I need all the users who all the mailbox-enabled users who have a certain Exchange property, but I need to go change some purely AD thing. They can go back and forth. They're both Exchange commands. So that's your gotcha there. I'd like to bring that up. That can be a real source of confusion for people. So the get AD user versus get user. Get mailbox statistics, that's another common one. People say, I needed to see how big mailboxes are, how full they are, how close to the limits they are. People do the get mailbox command expecting to find it. It's get mailbox statistics. And there's another one. You can pipeline the get user or the get mailbox into get mailbox. Show me certain ones. All the ones are in this NOU or in this property or whatever. Get a certain set of mailboxes, pipeline that into get mailbox statistics, and we can see that. If I want to see what their settings are for remote access, get client access mailboxes. Now, the one thing I do want to give you a little code snippet for is loading the Exchange commandlets for a script. That is one thing that is something I'm hoping Microsoft will kind of sort out at some point in time. That's what I had on my script over here, is that even in my remote session that I have in my PowerShell, I'll show you in just a moment, I can't actually run the Exchange management shells until I hook into the Exchange PowerShell stuff. And unfortunately, they have not taken that up. It's not just import module, done. The way they've chosen to do it is they've published it as basically as a URL like this. Basically as a web service, and I have to hook into it specifically using this command. So the recommended approach, some variable, $session, whatever, it doesn't really matter what you want to call it, the name isn't that important. The important thing is the new PS session command. Okay, configuration name, Microsoft.exchange. Then the connection URI, and then that's when you need to point it at one of your client access server roles, /PowerShell/, and authentication Kerberos. Once you've got that session connected, then I can do an import PS session to then make that connection. And now I'm in there. So we can see that here, if I switch over to, here's my remote PowerShell session. Now remember, this is my remote PowerShell session. On that Exchange server, if I try to do get mailbox, it returns, I don't know if you can read it, it says the term get mailbox is not recognized as a command, blah, 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 blah. Now note, here's that thing, get credential. So I'm going to run my script in here. Take my credentials. And we'll, you'll see it coming up here in a little bit. It took those credentials. It's now generating a new session hooking up. So again, since I did a hard reboot, we'll see what comes up. But hopefully it'll come up. It's looking promising so far. It'll come up, and now all of a sudden I will start having Exchange mailbox commands available to me. So I'll give that a second or two. Now, to be fair, I did not check all of my service starts on my Exchange server since I did a hard start on it. No, there we go. Okay, happily did it. Get commandlet. Da, da, da. Looks to be okay. So now, no, AKLEX1. It's weird. Even though I was on a, I know it's a bit weird. I was already on a remote PowerShell to the Exchange server, but I didn't have the, I wasn't basically hooked into the Exchange stuff. Now I am. Now I do get mailbox. Here's my list of mailboxes. Obviously, for that initial credentials, you might, if it's something, a script that needs to run after hours, you're going to have to basically automate that and feed those in, but you can do that. Okay. So that's a handy, looking back here, that's a handy little chunk of code to kind of keep it. You might want to add that dollar sign cred on top of that. Again, if you want a more detailed description of that, that's a really good article on TechNet for that. Remote management, looking at some of these bits and pieces in here. The biggest thing is pay attention to the commandlets that have a dash server switch. A lot of cases, if you have that, use that. It means I don't have to do anything. I don't have to worry about remote sessions or WinRM. They've written the connectivity stuff into the PowerShell commandlet itself. You give it a name, and as long as it will work, it will work. Highly recommend that. Now, because starting with Windows 2008 R2, basically the Windows remoting is turned on by default. As long as you're like within domain members, especially if you're working within the same Active Directory domain, you're logged on with appropriate credentials anyway. You can basically do things directly. I can use a command called invoke command. I don't again, prior to that, you had to go turn on WinRM, start a session manually, and then do that, and switch into the session, run a command. Now I can just run invoke command. Then the arguments for that are in there. I can still do create a new PS session, then enter in and swap back and forth. I'll be honest, because I use the ISE, I don't do that often anymore. I just use tabs for each one. You know, I'll have a remote tab, do what I want to do on that machine, and I'm happy there. But yeah, I can still do this. This is useful. The new PS session, enter PS session, is useful in scripting, so I can write a script that will work its way through a series of servers and go do the same thing over and over. So I can, you know, I can do this kind of stuff. So it still is valid. Again, the remote PowerShell tab in ISE. Okay, so here's a couple of syntax on that. Invoke command, computer name. Again, I can do it on a couple of them, so that's a nice thing. I can build that list through import CSV, something like that. But basically, then run a script block. The big thing, make sure you have a brace in there. So again, here, go get my event log for Windows PowerShell. So that's that basic command. That's a really useful one as a one-off. I just wanted to do something, check those things, or if I'm trying to gather information. Now, last but not least, this is something here for all of you SharePoint people. Like I said, the handful of you are SharePoint admins. It's one of those that drives me nuts. Or if you have a SharePoint environment, first thing in the morning, first user hits a SharePoint site, what's wrong with it? Painfully slow? Yeah. This is what I've got on here. You can use this, one of those things. I do have to do a little bit of back-end .NET geekery to this. What I have found, this works. So I can write this, put in the PowerShell script. So use this little code, create a variable called browser, new object system net web client, feed it default credentials, and then basically feed it the URLs you want to load. I can put as many of those in there, line after line of, dollar sign browser download string, or I can write a loop for this kind of stuff. So here, go hit the home page of all my SharePoint sites. Schedule this to run at 6 a.m. or so, after you've done your backup, after all your .NET sites have recycled their application pools, and so now when the first user comes in, they have to load everything from scratch. I can basically script that, so when people actually come in to do work, it's not quite so sluggish. So I thought I'd throw a bone to the SharePoint people. I know there's not that many of us out here. But to me, this is one of those things I'm like, there must be a way to do this. I'm tired of having to do things, finding these command line tools. There's got to be a way to do it in PowerShell. And there is. So that's the things I'm looking at. Now, hopefully none of these things, like I said, I know it's a lot of material, 10 things, you know, 1 hour, a lot of stuff in there. That's why I put all these code snippets. You can get this PowerPoint deck and all those kind of important ones. But I just want to say, you know, there's a lot of stuff. It's not, most of it's not that complicated once you take the time. I would encourage you, take the time, you know, spend here and there, learn how to drive if statements, how to learn the for each, learn the basic syntax. Take that time. Goes a long way towards doing these things. So I would like to thank you for your time. Are there any questions? It's just coming up to 10:40 now. So, yeah. You can still use the Windows out command and write a PowerShell script. The biggest problem with that, well, it's actually not that big an issue anymore. The biggest problem with that was that it would load a generic PowerShell window. So if you're using modules from other things, you had to make sure you put those code in there. So it's not a huge issue. There is now basically a scheduling, there are now scheduling PowerShell commandlets, so you can use those instead. And you're going to ask me what they are off the top of my head, and I don't know because I don't use them that often. But now I can do that from within the PowerShell. I can say, here, run this and run a script and run a console. So that makes it a little bit easier. But yeah. So I would say if you can do that, if you're using PowerShell 3 or newer, you have some commandlets that I can do, put in the scheduling, built into the PowerShell. Use that if you're using 2.0 or earlier. Or if, again, it's something, if I'm not sure what the PowerShell environment is going to run in and you're running a script, I tend to go with the lowest common denominator approach. It's a good question. If I had a hat or something, I'd give one to you. It was a good question. All right. Well, this coming up, just coming up. I've got 11:39 on my screen, so that's it. Thank you very much for your time. This morning. Hopefully, there's some useful stuff for you. If you have any questions or anything beyond that, you want to have a chat, I will be floating around here all day today and tomorrow and Friday. Find me at the certification center in room 3, or my blog, or I'm at Old House. We train. I run a PowerShell course. Come.